So, with all of that said, do you not perceive he's doing something new? I know that there's a million churches in Orange County. You can throw a rock and hit 20 of them. But this is the thing. We're not about competing against churches or saying one church is better or one is worse. Because, there's preaching. No, bad doctrine. We'll say, hey, not bad. But what I would say is this. Churches are like lighthouses. We don't compete. We just shine. We're all gathering around the well of everlasting life and saying, hey, I'm a beggar telling other beggars where to get water. That makes you never go thirsty again. So with that, I'm going to just share with you our vision of what we're doing. And forgive me, some of you have been to the Vision Night before. And the amazing thing about Vision Night is it's just kind of what we believe God has put on our hearts. It's not all there. So we're going to improvise, and we're going to be, you heard of the Reformation, right? You know, Martin Luther takes a thesis and he reformed the Catholic Church. We're called to be reformed, but always reforming, always listening to what the Spirit has to say. So this is just a dark, looking at it dimly. So the first thing is we are Everwell Church, and the reason why we're Everwell Church is we're going to get KJV on you, is, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Jesus comes to a Samaritan woman. The heat of the day, this young rabbi, he comes up and he says, if you just knew the water that I would give you, you would ask me for a drink of water. That's what we're doing here. We're saying, gather around the well of living water. Come, receive, go, and give. Because you can't go and give if you've never come and received from Jesus. You can't give something that you don't have. That's why we constantly come to the Word of God. That's why we constantly come every morning and say, God, what do you have for us to drink in? So not that it is ending with me, but I go and I give it away. So that is our verse. Memorize it. This is our mission statement. The mission is just what we're doing. We're gathering around the well of everlasting life. That's all we're doing. We're finding other people and saying, hey, come, drink. Some people, it's going to be this amazing thing, and they're going to be like, I want this water. And some people, no. But it's not our job to stop bringing them. We go out and we bring and say, come to the fountain, come to the waters and drink and never thirst again. So if Everwell's mission is gather around the well of everlasting life, then what are our values? So values are why we do things. Why, it's the fire in our belly. If the vision or the mission is what we're doing, the values are why are we doing it? Well, one is this, refreshment. There's five R's. Refreshment. Jesus, with the woman at the well, he comes up to her and he asks her for a drink, and she goes, what? Why would this 30-year-old rabbi ask me for a drink? He totally breaks her paradigm. I want Everwell Church to be a place to where there's no cliques. I know cliques are going to happen, but there people come in and they genuinely feel refreshed. I would love to see what God wants, which he has a holy people, pure, that we don't live like the world lives. So when they come in here, they're just like, man, this is refreshing. This is real. Not only do they have grace, but they also have truth. That's refreshing. Secondly, relationship. Jesus creates a relationship with the woman at the well. Who are you? Why would you do this? And he says, you have no idea what you're asking. You don't know what you want. And she gets all theological. I perceive you're a prophet and does all this thing. And Jesus meets her where she's at. Okay, let's talk this one through. One day there's going to be a time where we're not going to worship on a mountain or in a temple, but the people that will worship will be worshiping in spirit and in truth, like we did here in Fieldwork, in a co-working space. We're not in a holy temple. We're not in a big cathedral. We are in a co-working space, and we are singing worship songs to Jesus. And I pray that you are our forever family, that we get to sing and it doesn't stop till eternity ends. We want relationships to happen deep, just like the woman at the well. Thirdly, restoration. If there is not hope for dead things, Paul says, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, we are men most miserable. We should just all pack up and go. You guys shouldn't come here. You should just leave. If he did not resurrect, and that resurrecting power didn't rise other people from their dead lives into new life, then we should just go home. No matter how deep your sin goes, Jesus' love and grace goes further and deeper. There's no one too sinful for Jesus. That is what gives me fire in my belly, because we can see the worst of the worst and they can become restored in Jesus. Fourth, renewal. When you get a diet of everlasting life, water from the everwell, when you wrap your life around it, not only individually, but together as we gather on Sundays and we read from the scripture and we hear the gospel preached, when you wrap your life around that, you can't help but become renewed. You become a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things are passed away and the new has come. Just try to fight against it. You follow after Jesus. You allow the grace of God. It's not your works. It's not, you know, John Calvin said, God did not save you because you are handsome. Nothing you did. It's just Jesus, his grace. So that is a value that we hold dear. We want to see not only us as a community renewed, but we want to see Orange County, Costa Mesa renewed, bringing people to the water of Jesus, the water that he offers. And then lastly, revival. You don't think that with water, because usually when you drink too much water, you have to get revived, right? You have to get CPR done, right? It works opposite. The water that he gives you takes someone that is so parched and turns that person into a firefighter. Turns that person and says, I have the water of God, this abundant life, and the water is going to be piercing out of me. I'm going to give water out. I'm going to drink in deeply, but I'm going to serve, love, and die for others. That is the thing in our bones. The woman that had her life changed by Jesus goes back and says, there's a man that told me everything I have. They went and they said, hey, we went there because you said something, but now we heard him with our ears and we believe. This is not supposed to be done in a corner. The gospel of Christ is for the public space. The gospel of Christ is for Costa Mesa, Orange County, and the four corners of the world. If we're not doing this thing because we believe that God can revive a city, revive a county, revive an individual. Some people say, God, when I pray to you, why don't you answer my prayers? C.S. Lewis had this quote, and he says, the reason why God doesn't answer prayers is not because he's not powerful enough to give you what you're asking for. It's just that what you're asking for is too small. It's too weak. When God calls people and renews their heart, what pleases the Father's heart? Many knowing and coming to see his Son. Revival. That's what we're excited about. That's what gives us fire in our belly. Now, the strategy, or basically how we're going to do what we're going to do. I'm not going to reinvent the wheel. I don't have to. I don't have to do anything new. All we are going to do is we're going to gather together and worship. And worship is not just singing songs and praise, but it's giving our lives. It's serving others. It's being kind and gentle, loving one another. That's what worship is. So we're going to gather together and worship. We're going to gather together in prayer. We're going to pray together, because if there's no prayer, there's no power. What ends up happening is when we don't pray to God as a group of people, we become people that get our whole equilibrium or our whole axis off kilter. You want to know why there's so much anxiety in Orange County for people in the 21st century? Is anxiety is this. Anxiety is me praying to myself, what am I going to do about it? How am I going to get out of the thing? What am I going to do? That's anxiety, right? Man, what am I going to do? My job's not going the way that I wish it was going. My relationship's not going the way I wish it was going. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? You get anxiety. You know what prayer is? Prayer is taking those things and casting all of my burdens on Him. And then Him speaking back to us and saying, are you going to listen to me? Usually, sometimes when we call somebody on the phone, the person who calls the other person dictates what the phone conversation is about. Sometimes we need to stop talking and listen. Usually that's the word of God. Third, gathering together to disciple. That is one of the main engines. We have some older guys in here. We have some younger guys in here. Anybody can start a church, right? You grab a bunch of people, start a church, and then make a few disciples. But every time you make disciples, you get a church. Every time you make disciples, you get a church. The great omission is this, that He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And He says, go make disciples. We preach the gospel, we speak, but when's the last time a younger guy has been mentored in here? Hey, younger guys in here, I'm going to put you on the spot. How many of you guys have been mentored into what it's looked like to follow after Jesus? Mentor, just raise your hand. Anybody, or a few of you? One, two, three. How many of you haven't been? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Old guys, look around. How many of you old guys have been mentored and discipled? Okay, disciples make disciples. I don't care how beautiful this place is. If the engine isn't discipleship, if the engine isn't saying, hey, we're going to give you a pathway and handles in following the way of Jesus. This is what the Pharisees did. What the Pharisees did is it was like the older guys, and the Pharisees, what they would do is they would put these huge burdens and laws on people, but they wouldn't take a finger to help them with those burdens. All millennials are lazy, they're entitled, they're this, they're that. That's great. I believe that too. I'm that way. But will you lift a finger? Will you lift a finger and help us pursue after God? Help us love our wives. Help us love our kids. When our lives fall apart, will you help? Young women, how many of you have been discipled by an older woman? Raise your hand. Got one? Two. Okay. Older women, have you been discipled at all by anyone? Got one. We got some work. Because our strategy is to disciple. And the Great Commission is to preach the gospel and make disciples. Gather together to disciple. Fourth, gather together to serve. Jesus says, if you want to be great, He pivots it. He doesn't say, well, don't try to be great, try to be mediocre. Try to be just status quo. He says, no, if you want to be great, don't try to be the highest, be the servant of all. That's our strategy. How are we going to take Orange County for Jesus? We're just going to serve it. We're going to gather together and serve it. I don't know what that looks like yet. I'm depending on you. My job is just to equip you guys to come up with great ideas for the work of the ministry. I'm not going to listen to all of them, but I'll listen to some of them. And it doesn't really matter with me. Gathering together to evangelize. People, there's no revival if we're just all here talking to ourselves happy Jesus thoughts. It's not the point. The point is that people are living in a world, we're like scared that people are going to hell. No, be scared that people are already living in hell right now. Life without Jesus is a constant pursuit of meaninglessness. We evangelize for the here and now. God is judge, He will judge. There will be a day. But we disciple and we realize that people have hardship. So in the here and now, we evangelize so many can know Jesus. So that's our strategy. I know it's super amazing. It's a lot of marketing and all of those things. This is what I get excited about. I know the words are small, but I'll have them up later. These are the five men's, okay? And these are the marks and measures of our church. Usually, and my wife's going to hate this, okay? I'm going to say it. Usually, church is all about this. Butts and seats and bucks and budget. How many people you got coming? How much money you got? She hates it when I do that. I'm sorry, sweetheart. It's better than noses and nickels. I've heard that one too. That's a lousy thing. Those are good picture frames, but the frame of what we're doing, of what we're about, should not be the money and should not be the numbers. Because there's so many good churches that have tons of seats and has tons in their budget. But Jesus is outside knocking and saying, hey, can I come in? You know when they talk about Jesus knocking on the heart and letting him in? No, he's actually in the Bible. He's actually knocking in the church service. And they're all having a service. He's outside and they're not letting him in. Our marks and measures are these. And I call them the five ments. And I'm praying that everyone individually throughout their week will take a moment and think about it. That one's free. First one is this. Involvement at every level. No matter where you are, you can serve Jesus. Okay, here's the thing. The woman at the well, the first thing that Jesus asked the woman at the well to do is to serve him. Give me a drink of water. Okay, it wasn't speaking in front of a million people, but she was getting a glass of water and serving Jesus. If somebody comes in here and they want to serve, they're not going to be speaking, preaching, whatever, but they can help set up a little bit. I'm not going to make them, the worship leader tomorrow, but after the long obedience in the same direction, maybe one day, we believe in restoration. So this is a question that I hope that we would take a moment like that. And ask ourselves, where are you intentionally involved with Jesus? And we're going to talk about this however long with our church. Where are we as a church involved with Jesus? But where are you individually involved with Jesus? Ask that question to yourself. Secondly, movement in every area of life, no matter what stage of life, you must be moving. The worst type of water is stagnant water. The worst kind of Christians are stagnant Christians that aren't moving. If you ever go to Starbucks, the best kind of water at Starbucks is it's a constant flow of water. That's the type of water we're called to be. And so there are some of you that have come to your life and you're kind of like, I'm done. I made it. No, you haven't. Jesus is the one that you go after. You never stop moving. Maybe you're younger and you say, I can't stop moving. Well, maybe you should get connected with one of these old guys and they can make your life one that doesn't hurry or anxious, and they can help you along a path and say, hey, be still and know that he's God, but come along with me. Never stop moving. If we are doing these things, I really believe that we are being a church that is effective for his kingdom. Thirdly, contentment in every season. If you do not learn contentment in your winter, you will bring your discontentment into your spring. Whatever season of life you're in right now, if you bring discontentment into the next season, or you don't have contentment in this season of life, you'll bring it into the next. I could have a better car. I could have a better church. I could have better friends. Jesus says this in Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Here's the problem. That's the Nike Bible verse that acts like it's about overcoming anything. That's not what it's saying. What it says right before there is, I have learned to be content in every season. It's not about overcoming the mountain. It's about faithfully enduring and being content when the mountain is overcoming you and on top of you. I pray that our church is a church that learns true contentment in Jesus. So in movement, the question is, how are you moving towards becoming like Jesus? The third one is, when have you experienced contentment because of Jesus? I might not have a job. I might not know what the next day is going to bring. But when have I experienced contentment because of Jesus? Because he woke me up early this morning, and I'm going to be mad and say, why do you wake me up at 5:30? And he says, come away, my beloved. Come drink of the water. Fourth, commitment to the call. This is to all my friends and fellow brethren and women that are millennials. Committed to the call, no matter what the cost, committed to God's calling in our lives. What costly commitments are you enduring in joy for Jesus? I think baby boomers are awesome because they're high on commitment and low on community. They don't ask much of you. They don't ask too much of coffee. However, millennials, which I love, they're high on community. They always want to hang out, and I'm an extrovert. I love hanging out. But they're low on commitment. They'll be best friends with you for 3 weeks, and then you won't see them for 2 months, and you're like, where have you been? If Jesus calls you to commit to something, do it and endure it. It says that this, it was the joy that was set before Jesus that he endured the cross, despising the shame. He was fine. He went to the cross because you are his joy. God's glory was his joy, and he endured it, and he was committed to it. When Jesus calls a disciple, he calls them to come and die. Die to the things that you think are most important. Follow after me, my beloved. Then lastly, this is my favorite one, the new commandment. Who are you sacrificially loving in Jesus? This is the thing. What's the greatest commandment? Can anybody say it? Who is it? What's the greatest commandment? Scott, anyone? Okay, someone's saying it. Who's saying it? Heart, right, soul, and strength. And what? Sweet. That's awesome. Jesus asks that to a person, right? He ends up saying, he says, great, good job, you got the greatest commandment. A new commandment I give you. He pivots, he switches it. A new commandment I give you. Love one another as I have loved you, sacrificially. Not because you loved me in a certain way, you scratched my back, I scratched your back. He says, no, I give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you, so you must you love one another. This, if we could be the church that loves each other, it's over. It's over because there's no rumors or jealousy among us. There's grace, there's peace, there's hope. We're going to have tough conversations because we have to be people of truth. We're not just hippies saying, oh, bro, it's just grace. It is just grace, and it is just truth. So, these are the moments that I'm saying, who are you sacrificially loving in Jesus? And those are the five men's. So lastly, and I'm going to get out of here and I'm going to make this quick. This is the destination. Where are we going? What does this hall look like? I still don't really know. It's very dim. But we hope, because it's a church plant, we hope to plant a sustainable, organic, life-giving church. Okay? Because it's a plant. Plants, you get it? That's what we're hoping to be. This is the vision. One, sustainability. It takes honesty of saying, hey, we're just a small church. We're just a small plant. That's all we are. We'll die if no one cultivates us. We'll die if no one waters us. We'll die if no one prunes us. But it says this, that he is the vine and we are the branches, and he who abides in him will bear much fruit. I can only produce the fruit as much as I am abiding in the vine. Right? And so sustainability takes honesty, right? That's honesty of on all of our parts to see where there needs to be service, there needs to be help, there needs to be, you say, man, you come into the church and you see everything, what's wrong with it. Oh, that's not good, that's not good, that's not good. He's too short, he's not funny enough, he's not cool enough. I don't like that group, I don't know. Instead of saying, how can I love, serve that group? How can I get in here? How can I make this thing sustainable? Because it's not my energy, it's God's energy. And then it takes transparency seriously. I want to be a church that when you look at me, you know what you're getting. That I can be transparent with you. That I can tell you what's up. And I might not do it to the best of your liking, but that's the goal. That's our vision. We want to be sustainable. It takes honesty, but also takes transparency. And I realize that. Secondly, growing organically takes natural hard work. Cece, where are you? You're right there. Cece has an organic garden in her house. And if you ask her and say, not in her house, outside of her house, in the backyard. If you ask her and say, hey, how is it having an organic garden? It's probably not hard work at all. You just let it happen organically, right? She would laugh at you. Because she doesn't get to use Roundup. She doesn't get to use all of these, you know, things that might kill the weeds faster. She has to cultivate. She has to be intentional. This church will not become sustainable, or it's not going to happen organically just by saying that. It's actually going to take more work, natural hard work. But also, it takes intentionality. How can I be intentional? How can I self-start? How is the gospel? How have I experienced the joy of Jesus so much that I can now serve, not only on a Sunday, but through the week? Lastly, living generously. We want to be a life-giving church. So living generously takes gratitude for the fruit. So any fruit that Everwell Church happens, whether it's corporately or individually, any fruit that we get, we are grateful for. We say, God, we're so grateful for what you've done. But then we look at the seed and we don't take the seed and eat it. We take the seed and we go and plant others. We say, hey, how can we be generous to this church plant? How can we be generous to this people that are suffering? Living generously takes gratitude for the fruit that is produced. Get it? Produce. And generously sacrificing so other seeds might be planted. This is Everwell Church. We are a church that loves Jesus. We are a church that loves the gospel. I'm still amazed at how many of you guys showed up. Thankful for you guys. I'm going to pray. It's 8:48. We're going to have a few songs of worship. If you have to go, I realize that we might go 15 minutes over and pray. So if you have to leave, please do just exit quietly. But if you can stay and pray, we'd love for you to. So if Jack can come up and share, and we'll pray. God, I thank you so much. You are doing a new thing. And it's all because of your Son. And God, I just pray that we'd be obedient to the call, that we'd be faithful to it. God, if people are praying about helping out and gathering around with us, I pray that they would. But Lord, I pray if there's divisiveness, there's pride, if there's people that would come here and want to see a small plant and birds would come and get in and try to take from it, Lord, I just pray against all the foul demonic things that come in. All the people that want to make their wills great, their names great, I just pray that they would cast it all aside. Lord, I pray, you say, I send you out now, sheep amongst wolves. We know that you're the good shepherd. So, Father, I just pray right now that you protect your sheep in this time, that people's hearts would be seasoned with grace. In your name.